वेलकम. वी आर इन द सेकंड लेक्चर ऑफ द फिफ्थ मॉड्यूल, दैट इज हीट इंटीग्रेशन डिजाइन ऑफ द प्रोसेस. इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर्स वी सॉ सम बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स एंड प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ हीट रिकवरी एंड हीट इंटीग्रेशन ऑफ द प्रोसेस. वी सॉ एज हाउ डिफरेंट प्रोसेस स्ट्रीम्स इन द प्रोसेस कैन बी रिप्रेजेंटेड ऑन अ HT डायग्राम, एंड देन वी कैन आइडेंटिफाई द मैक्सिमम हीट रिकवरी बिटवीन these streams, and then we also saw how we can identify the minimum hot and cold utility requirement. The major variable in the heat integration of the process was delta T min, the minimum temperature difference that could exist at any one end of the heat exchangers that are in the process. So we saw as how the value of delta T min can be decided, and how does this value change the entire feature of the process. Increasing delta T min reduces the areas of heat exchangers, that reducing the capital cost, but at the same time they increase the load on minimum hot and cold utility requirement, thus increasing the operating cost. So then there has to be an economic trade off. We first saw this concept for single streams, then we extended that to multiple streams, then we also saw the special case of threshold problems, and now in this lecture we continue the same theme for determining the QH min and QC min without plotting graphs. The method of plotting graphs is easy, but when you have very large number of streams, then it becomes cumbersome, okay, because the slopes of the graph changes as the Cp value change with different temperature interval, and then it becomes rather difficult to determine QH min and QC min accurately. So we shall now see an alternate algorithm for determination of the minimum hot and cold utility of the process, that is known as problem table algorithm. We need to develop method for calculating the energy targets without need for graphical construction. The process is first divided into the temperature intervals in the same way as for the composite curves. It is not possible to recover all heat in each temperature interval, since the temperature driving forces are not feasible throughout the interval. The problem can be overcome if for construction purposes the hot composite curve is assumed to be delta T min by 2 colder, means the temperatures are reduced by quantity delta T min by 2, and then it is in practice, and the cold composite curve is pretended to be delta T min by 2 hotter, thus increase the temperature exactly by same quantity as you have reduced the temperatures of for hot streams, okay, then it is in practice. The shifted composite curves touch each other at pinch. Okay, in the previous lecture we saw how we can shift the composite curves horizontally and set the minimum temperature difference between the streams. But when you reduce the temperatures of hot streams by delta T min by 2 and increase the temperature of the cold streams by delta by the same quantity, then the difference between the two streams reduces to 0, and the shifted composite curves touch each other at the pinch. Carrying out heat balance between the shifted temperature interval shows that heat transfer is feasible throughout each shifted temperature interval. Within each shifted temperature interval, the hot streams are in reality hotter than the cold streams by just delta T min. Okay? That is what it is. Means in reality, the difference exists by delta T min. The vertical shift of the curves does not alter the horizontal overlap, and hence the extension of the cold composite curves beyond the start of hot composite curve and vice versa. So the QH min and QC min does not change. It only removes the problem of ensuring the temperature feasibility within the given temperature interval. Shifting techniques also helps in calculation of the energy target without actually graphical plotting of the composite curves. Now let us see how. The steps involved in this algorithm: first, set up the shifted temperature interval, then for each shifted temperature interval calculate the simple energy balance. Delta HI is equal to summation CPC for all cold streams minus summation CPH for all hot streams into delta TI, the temperature difference of that interval. Okay. So delta HI is the heat balance for shifted interval I, delta TI is the temperature difference across interval. If the cold streams dominate hot streams, the interval has net heat deficit and delta H is positive. Okay. Otherwise, the interval has net surplus of heat, and delta H is negative. Okay, and this is consistent with standard thermodynamic conventions. What you see is the shifted composite curve. If no hot utility is used, the above calculation is equivalent to constructing shifted composite curve. Overlap in the shifted curve means heat transfer is infeasible. That is what is being shown here. If the hot composite curve goes below the cold composite curve at any point, then here that delta T becomes negative and there is no heat transfer feasible. Overlap is maximum at some point. This maximum overlap is added as hot utility. So, this is the maximum overlap which is added as hot utility, okay, here this one. So, that when these curves shift horizontally, then they touch each other at this point. So, this becomes like the whole situation becomes like this, the curves touch each other. So, this is parallel line, this, and this is another parallel line. So, this is the pinch when you add the hot utility. The overlap in shifted curves means the heat transfer is infeasible, overlap is maximum at some point, this maximum overlap is added as hot utility. With this, the shifted curves touch at the pinch and actual curves are separated by delta T min. We shall see exactly the same problem as in the previous lecture, the reactor, two reactors with different feeds and products, and then we shall try to determine the minimum hot utility and minimum cold utility using problem table algorithm. So, I have given here the data again, the stream data. Reactor 1 feed is a cold stream with supply temperature of 20 degrees, target temperature of 180 degrees. Reactor 1 product is a hot stream with supply temperature of 250, target temperature of 40. Reactor 2 feed is a cold stream with supply temperature 140, target temperature 230. And reactor 2 product is again a hot stream with supply of 200, target of 80 degrees. Okay. So, together we have 61.5, these two minus thing, 61.5 megawatt of excess heat, and the heat requirement is 59 megawatt of the two cold streams. Now, we assume delta T min to be 10 degrees centigrade as in the previous case. So, the step one according to the algorithm is to determine the shifted temperature interval that we denote by T star by shifting down the hot stream temperature by delta T min and shifting up the cold stream temperatures by delta T min. So, the stream 1 which was cold, the supply temperature was 20, we now increase it by delta T min by 2, that is 5 degrees, and make it 25. Similarly, the target temperature is increased from 180 to 185. The stream 2 which was a hot stream, reactor 1 product, the supply temperature was 250, which is reduced to 245, the target temperature was 40, which is reduced to 35. Okay. And therefore, we have here the table of shifted temperature interval. Okay. Okay. Some shifted intervals have surplus heat, while some have heat deficit. We shall plot these streams in a stream population diagram. What we have done here now, the diagram that appears on your screen. We have listed here all the temperatures that are in the process in the ascending order. So, the least temperature was 20 degrees, which is like cold stream which is shifted by 5 degrees. So, it becomes 25, then 35, that temperature was 40, you can see here. Okay. The least temperature shifted temperature interval. Okay. Look at the box that is marked in red. The least temperature is 25, thereafter 35. Thereafter 75, okay, like that. And then we have arranged all these temperatures in ascending order. And then we have also marked the streams in these intervals. Like stream 1 goes from 20 to 180. So, shifted temperature interval 25 to 185. Then stream 2 goes from 250 to 40. So, in shifted temperature interval 245 to 35. And I have also written here the Cp values against these arrows. Okay. So, the arrows show the range of the streams in temperature interval, and the Cp values that are written against the arrows are the heat capacity flow rates. Okay. And then the third column is delta T of that interval. Okay. The first interval is from 245 to 235, so 10 degrees, then 235 to 195, then 40 degrees, like that. Okay, so 10, 40, 70, 40, 10. So these are the temperature intervals in degrees centigrade. And the next step is to calculate the summation CPC by summation CPH. Okay. Here the unit is megawatt per degree centigrade. Okay. The difference in heat capacities. Okay. So in the first temperature interval, there is no cold stream here. Okay. In the first temperature interval, 245 to 235, the hot stream is, the only hot stream is stream 2 with Cp equal to 0.15. So that becomes minus 0.15. In the next interval, however, we have one cold and one hot stream. The cold stream is stream 3 with Cp equal to 0.3. The cold stream is stream 2 with Cp equal to 0.15. So 0.3 minus 0.15 is plus 0.15. Okay. And then similarly, we go ahead. The third interval, 185 to 195, we have two hot streams, second and fourth, and one cold stream. Okay. So 0.15 plus 0.25, okay, that is 0.4 minus 0.3, sorry, two hot streams, 0.3 minus 0.4, so minus 0.1, and so on and so forth. So we have now listed the summation CPC minus summation CPH values. Okay. Now the delta H in that interval, the heat surplus or deficit, that can be obtained by multiplication of the third and fourth column, okay, delta T interval into summation CPC minus summation CPH. So in the first temperature interval, we have minus 0.15 into 10, that is minus 1.5 megawatt of surplus heat. Then in the next interval, we have CPC is 0.15 into 40, that delta T temperature, so 6 megawatts of heat deficit, okay, and then so on and so forth. So next interval we have minus 1 megawatt of surplus heat, next interval plus 4 megawatt of heat deficit, okay, and this thing. So we have now completed the algorithm. Now the next step is to, how do we now transfer heat? You can keep on transferring heat from higher temperature to lower temperature, okay. So that we shall do now. We shall now add the cumulative heat values. Okay. So let us say that at 245 degrees we start, so that is 0. So between 245 to 235 we have 1.5 megawatt of heat. Okay. Now this heat could be utilized to satisfy the heat deficit of the next temperature interval, that is between 235 and 195. Here we have 6 megawatts of deficit, out of which 1.5 megawatt could be taken care by the surplus heat available in the previous higher temperature interval. So that leaves us with a deficit of minus 4.5, okay, 6 minus 1.5 minus 4.5. In the next temperature interval, we have minus 1 megawatt of excess heat, okay, so that can satisfy the the heat deficit in the previous interval, so minus 3.5, and so on and so forth. So you can see here the cumulative delta H values, okay, and then let us see where is the maximum deficit in this whole thing, that is in the temperature interval of 185 to 145, that is minus 7.5 megawatt, okay. So this particular deficit has to be, so this is the maximum. So going back to this diagram where we had seen that where is the maximum overlap, okay, overlap in shifted curve means the heat transfer is infeasible, overlap is maximum at some point, and this is a this maximum overlap is added as hot utility. So essentially what we have done is that we have identified the maximum overlap, the maximum overlap between the shifted temperature composite curves, and that is 7.5 megawatt. Now this much of heat needs to be added from hot utility, and then it will satisfy the entire process. So now we add 7.5 megawatt of hot utility from, let us say, some source steam. Okay, so that 7.5, that is at, so that we start with 7.5 megawatt of heat, okay, So at 245 we have 7.5 megawatt of heat. Let us say we have steam which is available at 240 degrees. But this is, remember, this is a shifted, this is actual temperature interval. So we have to consider 245 degrees, and that is 7.5 megawatt at 245 degrees. So we start with 7.5 megawatt of hot utility. That next interval, to this 7.5, the 1.5 megawatt of the surplus heat between 245 and 235 degrees centigrade add. So together in the next, at 235 degrees, we have 9 megawatt of surplus heat that can take care of the 6 megawatt deficit in the next temperature interval, 195 to 235. So we are left with 3 megawatt, and so on and so forth. You just keep on going downward by subtracting these values. Now 3 megawatt in the 195 temperature interval, to that minus 1 megawatt of 185 degree, this is surplus, okay, minus 1 megawatt. So that adds, so 3 minus minus 1, so becomes 4. Okay. Now this 4 megawatt, this 4 megawatt of heat available at 185 degrees can take care of 4 megawatt heat at 145. So here the net heat flow becomes 0. So this is the pinch temperature. Okay. Net heat flow becomes 0 here. And thereafter we have 14 megawatts of surplus heat which can take care of the 4 megawatt of heat available, heat requirement in the next two temperature interval, 2 plus 2, total 4 megawatt of heat. And finally we are left with 10 megawatts of surplus heat which needs to be rejected to the cold utility. So thus the problem table algorithm has given us the answer that we are seeking for. We have to add 7.5 megawatt of QH minimum, and we are finally left with 10 megawatt to be rejected to cold utility, that is QC minimum. Okay. The smallest amount of heat added from hot utility is the largest negative heat flow, that is 7.5 megawatt. This does not change the heat balance, but gives just the zero heat flow at the interval of interval temperature of 145 degrees. Okay. And then finally we arrive at the answer that we are looking for, so that from the problem table algorithm we have found the minimum hot utility as 7.5 megawatt and minimum cold utility as 10 megawatt. Okay. Now another point which I already mentioned, but I repeat because it is important, the heat flow goes to 0 at 145 degree centigrade. This corresponds to the pinch. Okay. But remember, 145 degree is a shifted temperature interval. Okay. So for this particular temperature, the hot streams are 145 plus 5 degrees, that is 150 degree centigrade, and the cold streams are 145 minus 5, that is 140 degree centigrade. So the actual hot and cold stream temperatures are 150 and 140 degrees centigrade. So that is, we have answers to all the questions that we are looking for without plotting a graph. Okay. We have determined the minimum hot and cold utility requirement, and we have also determined the pinch temperatures, the temperatures of hot and cold composite streams at which the pinch occurs. Okay. Now there are certain process constraints. Okay. So far we have assumed that any hot stream can be mixed with any cold stream, okay, or can be coupled, not mixed, it should be coupled, can be coupled to any this thing, cold stream, can be coupled with any cold stream, provided there is no feasible temperature difference between the two. Okay. But some practical constraints are available, possible, okay, some practical constraints can prevent this particular coupling. Some examples of these are, if the two streams are matched in heat exchanger and leak develops, such as there is such that if streams contact, then hazardous situation can be produced. This imposes the constraint. Usually the phases of the two streams have to be same. If they are vapor phase, gas phase, if there is any phase change, then sudden pressure drop can occur. So there are certain constraints which can prevent coupling of the streams. Okay. So geographical location of the streams may also put constraint, as we cannot have unacceptably long pipelines, okay, and potential control and startup of the problem can also impose constraint. Let us see one such constraint, like the areas of integrity. This is a common reason for constraint. Okay. The process often has logically identified sections or areas, the entire plant. Okay. For example, one area of the plant is the reaction area, then another area is separation area, and these areas are kept separate for reasons such as startup, shutdown, operational flexibility or safety, etc. Okay. These areas are made independent of each other by intermediate storage of the process materials. Such independent areas are called areas of integrity and impose constraint on ability for heat transfer. To maintain the operational independence, the two areas cannot be dependent on each other for heating and cooling recovery. So, let us evaluate the effect of constraint on system performance. Now, suppose there is a constraint, then how it affects the system performance, how it affects the minimum hot utility requirement, minimum cold utility requirement. So, we see now an example. The problem table algorithm cannot be used directly in such cases. The effect of constraints on energy performance can be evaluated using problem table algorithm together with some common sense. The process is to be divided in operationally independent areas of integrity A and B. Okay. The stream data for areas is to be listed. Now, we shall see an example. Okay. And then we have to calculate the penalty in utility consumption to maintain the two areas of integrity with certain delta T min. Now, let us assume a value of 20 degrees. I have given here an example. Suppose we have two areas in the plant, one area A and another area B. Okay. And there are two streams in each of these areas. Stream 1, area A has stream 1, supply temperature 190, target temperature 110, that is the hot stream, and then the second stream, which is cold stream, the supply temperature 90, target temperature 170. Similarly, area B has one hot stream, supply temperature 140, target temperature 50, and another cold stream, supply temperature 30, target temperature 120. The Cp values are also listed, the heat capacity flow rate values in kilowatt per degree centigrade. By multiplying the delta T with Cp, you will get the heat that is available, okay? Available with hot stream, and that is heat required for cold stream. To identify penalty, first calculate the utility consumption of two areas separately from each other, and next combine all streams from both areas and again calculate the utility consumption. For each area, we have QH min, QC min. So, area A, QH min A, QC min A. For area B, QH min B, QC min B, and then the combined area. Now, let us try to do this with the area A with only two streams. Okay. Here we have delta T min is 20 degrees. So, we have to shift the temperatures by 10 degrees. Okay. So, here the hot stream is, the shifted temperature is 180 and 100. So, 180 and 100, and then the delta Cp value is 2.5. Okay. So, we have 2.5 into 80, okay, delta T interval 80, and then we have another stream of another cold stream that is available at 90 degrees, and it has to be heated to 170 degrees. So, the shifted temperatures are 100 and 180. Okay. So, that requires 80 into 220, that is 1600 kilowatt of energy. Okay. The one that could be supplied through the hot stream is 200, okay, 2.5. Okay. So, here I'll write the balances for you. Summation CPC minus summation CPH is 17.5 into 80. So, that is 1400 kilowatts of heat that is required. Similarly, in this case, in the second case, okay, if you see summation CPC, summation CPH, okay, summation, that summation is minus 15, summation CPC minus summation CPH into 90. Okay, so that gives 1350 kilowatt of heat. Okay. So the cold utility consumption in this case is 1350 megawatt, kilowatt, and the hot utility consumption in case of area A is 1400 kilowatt. Okay. Now, if these areas are kept independent of each other. Now, if you combine the two areas, then we have the same problem table algorithm as before. We have to list all the temperatures in descending order, all the shifted temperature intervals, and then we have to mark the streams between these temperatures. Stream 1 goes from 180 to 100, Cp value is 2.5, then stream 2 goes from 100 to 180 with Cp value of 20, stream 3 goes from 130 to 40 with Cp value of 20, and stream 4 goes from 40 to 130 with Cp value of 5. Okay. Then the delta T interval is in the first case 50 degrees, 180 to 130, then 30, and then 60 degrees. Okay. Then summation CPC minus summation CPH this is plus 17.5 in this case, because there is one hot in between 180 to 130, we have one hot stream with Cp 20, one cold stream with Cp 20, one hot stream with Cp 2.5. So, it becomes plus 17.5. In the next interval, we have all four streams. So, two hot streams with total Cp of 22.5 and two cold streams with total Cp of 25. So, 25 minus 22.5 becomes plus 2.5, and then in the next interval between 100 and 40, we have one cold stream with 5 Cp and one hot stream with Cp equal to 20. So, 5 minus 20 is minus 15. The delta H interval just we have to multiply Cp summation CPC minus summation CPH with delta T. So, plus 870, so this is not megawatt but kilowatt. Okay. That's plus 875 plus 75. Minus 900. So, we have two intervals of deficit followed by last interval of surplus. Now, we cannot transfer heat at 40 degrees to satisfy heat requirement at 100 degrees. Okay. Reverse is not possible. This is possible, but this is not possible. Okay. Therefore, we have to now here add 875 to satisfy the deficits in the first two temperature intervals. We have to add total 875 plus 75, that 950 megawatts of 950 kilowatts of hot utility, heat from hot utility, and then it will make the heat balance 0 at 100 degrees centigrade. Okay, and then we are left with 900 kilowatts of heat in the next interval, last interval, to be rejected to cold utility. So, the QH min is 950 kilowatts, QC min is 900 kilowatts. If the two areas are combined, however, if the two areas are separate, kept separate because of the constraints that I mentioned before, if the areas are physically quite far apart, then we have to transport a lot of material through pipes, which is not only cost intensive because we have to use pumps or compressors, but it can also cause significant temperature drop during transportation, and the temperature that is actually achieved at the place of exchanger may not be same as at the source, which is used for calculation. So, because of these constraints, we cannot couple all streams, any stream with any stream. So, we have to keep the area separate. So, however, two areas are kept separate, then the total load on utilities are, that we just determined, hot utility 1400 megawatt, cold utility 1350 megawatt. QH min 1400 kilowatt, QC min 1350 kilowatt. So, the penalty for maintaining areas of integrity is 1400 minus 950 kilowatt of hot utility. So, 450 kilowatt of hot utility and 1350 minus 900, that is another 450 kilowatt of cold utility. The penalty as a result of constraint enables the judgment as whether it is acceptable or too expensive. If it is too expensive, then we have two choices. That point we note. If the areas of integrity cause excessive expense, then we have two choices. First choice is that reject areas of integrity and operate the process as a single system. That is one option, and second option is to find a way to overcome the constraint while maintaining the areas. Now, how this could be achieved? A simple option is to use an existing utility system as buffer, using one stream to generate steam to be fed into a steam mains and another stream to use that steam from the same mains. So, that point we note, the option of indirect heat transfer between areas. And the simple option in this case is that use existing utility system. As buffer, use one stream to generate steam. And is fed into steam mains or steam source, central source of steam. And other option is that use a heat transfer medium such as oil that circulates between the two streams matched. Use a heat transfer medium such as hot oil that circulates between the two streams. Matched. So, these are the options. And then we are left with one final point to close this lecture. That is the selection of utility. Now, after maximizing the heat recovery in the network, the heating and cooling duties must be served by the heating and cooling duties that are not served by heat recovery must be provided by external utilities. Okay. External utilities should provide the heat duties not served by heat recovery. Now, what are the possible utilities? Possible utilities are most common hot utility is steam, which is at different level, high pressure steam, medium pressure steam, low pressure steam, depending on the temperature levels. Then high temperature heat duties require furnace flue gases or hot oil circuit. Okay. Furnace flue gases, then hot oil circuit. In some cases, molten salt or even molten metal is used as a heat transfer medium for very high temperature processes. Dowthum liquids are also quite common. As far as possible, the idea is to avoid phase change in the heat exchanger, so that the pressure drop across the heat exchanger remains constant. So, in such cases, the Dowthum liquids or molten salts are quite frequently used. Okay. The cold utilities that are used in the process are the cooling water, the most common. The typical range of temperature range is, let us say, 20 to 25 degrees to about 50 degrees, depending on location, humidity, etcetera. You have already dealt with this cooling towers in the mass transfer course, so that is already known to you. Cooling water. Then, if the vapors condense at temperature lesser than 30 degrees, okay, or the room temperature, then you have to go for refrigeration. Chilled water is also an option. Chilled water which is supplied at 4 degrees and comes out at about 10 to 15 degrees, okay, that is an option. Then air cooling, then in some cases BFW, that boiler fed water, is used as heat transfer medium. This water absorbs the heat by phase change, okay, and steam is generated. This is for highly exothermic reactions, like for example polymerization reactions or Fischer drop synthesis, where the boiler fed water is used for steam generation. Okay. Now, the composite curves can be used to set the energy targets, but not for the selection of utilities. So, the analysis that we have seen in this lecture as well as previous lecture, analysis for heat integration, gives us energy targets, but not the utilities, the selection of utility. So, the grand composite curve is a means for this. Grand composite curve is more appropriate tool for understanding interfacing between process and utility system. Now, the grand composite curve, which is often abbreviated as GCC, can be obtained by plotting the problem table cascade. And this shows the heat flow through the process against temperature. Whatever data that we had, if we plot T star versus delta H that we have obtained, you may get curves something like this. The pockets of heat recovery, this means the H value delta H changes, and at pinch delta H goes to 0, and then again this thing. So, the open jaws in this curve are the pockets of heat recovery. Okay. The point of zero heat flow is the pinch point. And the open jaws at the top and bottom represent QH min and QC min. Now, the heat sink above pinch and heat source below pinch can be identified with this. Okay, so that point we are noting. Open jaws at top and bottom, represent QH min and QC min. The open jaws are the shaded areas represent the areas of additional process to process heat transfer. The profile of grand composite curve represents the residual heating and cooling demand after recovering the heat within shifted temperature interval in the problem table algorithm. So, in the pockets that are shown, the local surplus of heat in the process is used at temperature differences in excess of delta T min to satisfy the local deficit. So, those points I am noting for you. Profile of GCC represents residual heating and cooling demands after recovering heat within shifted temperature interval in the problem table algorithm. And the local surplus of heat in the pockets that are shown, the local surplus of heat in process is used at temperature differences in excess of delta T min to satisfy local deficit. There are two options, like grand composite curve, how it can be used. Okay. Now, two levels of saturated steam can be produced. Two levels of saturated steam is at hot utility, and then the low pressure steam being desuperated by injection of boiler fed water after the pressure reduction to maintain saturated conditions. Okay. So, that is how. What we do is that the boiler produces superheated steam, which is desuperheated by injection of boiler fed water. And in some cases, even hot oil can be used for circulation. Between the areas of integrity. Now, let us see how we can represent these two options on a GCC. Now, the first option, that is steam generation. The high pressure steam okay, could be made saturated in this temperature zone. The grand composite curve with two levels of saturated steam as hot utility. Okay, the low pressure steam, high pressure steam being desuperated by injection of boiler fed water after pressure reduction to maintain saturated condition. So this is the region of HP steam generation, the open jaws that have heat pockets, pockets for heat recovery. So this is a probable area for generation of high pressure steam. Otherwise, you can also have a hot oil circulation that can directly go in this, which can provide heat from the source to the sink. Okay, this is hot oil circulation. So the two areas, the two options of additional heat recovery or selection of utility can be identified with the grand composite curve. That completes our discussion on principles of heat integration.